Good morning. Let us continue our discussion about cyclic codes. In the previous classes, we had analyzed what is the concept of division and how to realize division circuits using hardware. And based on those division circuits, we also analyzed how to work with encoder, the encoder of cyclic codes using division circuits. In this class, let's consider about how to draw divider circuits using linear feedback shift registers for syndrome calculation in an n comma k cyclic code. So we are planning to do syndrome calculation in this class. Also on how to draw a general decoder circuit to detect and correct errors in cyclic codes. So what is this error detection and correction in cyclic codes? How can it be done? Basically, let's consider the code vector to be V0. Suppose the code vector V is V0, V1, so on, Vn minus 1, and it is transmitted over a noisy channel. So the received vector can be a corrupted version of the code vector. So you have transmitted all the bits from V0 to Vn minus 1 over a noisy channel and you have received something. The received version need not be perfect. It can be a corrupted version of what was sent. Let's call the received vector as R0, R1, R2, so on till Rn minus 1. Okay. The received vector need not be any one among the 2 power k valid code vectors. Remember, if we have k bits of data, I'll have only 2 to the power of k valid code vectors. I can't have more than that. And there are chances that the received vector will not be one among the 2 power k valid code vectors. So, the function of the decoder is to determine whether there is an error in the received vector, and if there is an error, what is the position of error and how it could be corrected. So just like in linear block codes, the decoder will first compute the syndrome here. So it's going to compute the syndrome, and after computation of syndrome, you'll know whether you have a valid code vector or not. So if syndrome is 0, then you have received the correct code vector. If syndrome is not 0, then you haven't received the correct one. There is an error. So much we can find out. And in cyclic codes, okay, if the syndrome is 0, received code word polynomial should be divisible by the generator. Remember, we are talking in terms of polynomials in cyclic codes. And here, if the received polynomial is properly divisible by the generator polynomial, then I know it is created by the same generator. It will be a multiple which is obtained by shifting the generator, right? So it is created using the same generator, and hence I know it is a valid code vector. But when you divide the received polynomial with the generator and a remainder is left out, in that case it is not correctly divisible and there is an error. So it may not be generated using that generator. Okay. So as you can observe here, we have a noisy channel and the code vector V of X is fed in. The received vector R can be written as sum of V plus E, or the valid code vector plus the error vector. Now, the received vector R can be written as, or as a polynomial, R of X can be written as R0 plus R1 into X plus R2 into X square plus Rn minus 1 into X to the power of n minus 1. We know this is how we can express given bits as coefficients of a polynomial in variable x. Let us consider a of x to be the quotient and s of x to be the remainder polynomials after dividing R by G. I divide the received polynomial with the generator, then A is supposed to be the quotient and S of X is supposed to be the remainder polynomial. Okay, so we can express it using this equation. See, in general, using divisibility theorem, R of X can be written as quotient into divisor plus remainder. This is how we express a given polynomial. If I divide throughout with G of X, then I'll get this equation. So you divide completely with G of X, then you're going to get this equation, R of X by G of X on the LHS, the quotient A of X, G of X cancels, plus remainder divided by G of X. This remainder S of X is a polynomial of degree n minus k minus 1 or less. Please remember, the syndrome polynomial will have maximum of n minus k bits. So if I consider the order or the highest degree of a polynomial created using that syndrome, the highest degree can be n minus k minus 1. Okay, and if we say, for example, let E of X be a polynomial representing an error pattern which is caused by the channel, then we know I can write the received polynomial R of X as the transmitted code polynomial V of X plus the error polynomial E of X. We know this. Now, we also know that the transmitted code polynomial can be obtained as data, either we normally used to take it as D of X or U of X into the generator polynomial G of X. So, the code polynomial is data into generator. If I substitute for V of X, what would I get? I would get R of X is equal to U of X into G of X plus E of X. Now, I divide by G of X throughout. So, divide this equation throughout by G of X. What would you get? R of X by G of X is equal to U of X plus E of X by G of X. Right? Now, I have a similar equation here. I'll call it equation A, and a similar equation here, equation B. Look at the LHS, R of X by G of X, I have in both the equations. Therefore, considering equation A is equal to equation B on RHS also. Since LHS of these two equations are same, on RHS also, if I consider them as equal, what would I get? I will get A of X plus S of X by G of X is equal to, I'll be getting this actually, A of X plus S of X by G of X is equal to, what do I have here? U of X plus E of X by G of X. Now, if I want to isolate for E of X, the error function, the error pattern E of X, if I want to isolate, you'll get this expression as shown here. E of X will be A of X on this side plus U of X get shifted. I told you minus and plus are same. Here in polynomial modulo 2 algebra, addition and subtraction are the same. So even though I take this U of X to the other side, rather than minus, we'll write it as plus itself. The quotient A plus data polynomial U of X, the whole thing into G of X plus S of X will give me E of X, right? So this is how I get this equation. And what is clear for us from this equation? That the error pattern E is a function of the syndrome polynomial This error pattern E is a function of the syndrome polynomial S of X. Okay, hence we can determine whether there is an error in a given received cyclic code by calculating its syndrome polynomial S of X. That's what we wanted to prove. We want to show that the error in the received code vector is a function of the syndrome. Okay. Now, based on our analysis of division circuits, which we had done in the last class, the syndrome calculation circuit can be written as shown. You can see here the same division circuit we have used. Okay, the received vector, code vector R of X, or the received code polynomial is given to a modulo 2 adder and then to the first flip-flop in the shift register. Remember, I need a shift register having, so the shift register has n minus k flip-flops. There are n minus k flip-flops in the shift register, as you can see, S0, S1, Sn minus k minus 2, Sn minus k minus 1. So total of n minus k shift register flip-flops in the shift register and maximum of n minus k modulo 2 adders. You see, before every flip-flop we have one modulo 2 adder, but in the final circuit the presence of this modulo 2 adder depends on whether the generator coefficient at this point is a 1 or a 0. Only when the generator coefficient at this point is a 1, then we need this modulo 2 adder, because there will be a short connection from the output of gate 1 to this point. But if the generator coefficient there was 0, then that modulo 2 adder can be avoided. We can directly connect the output of S1 to the next stage. Okay. So how does this, and we have two gates as you can observe. Gate 2 is initially switched on until all bits of the received vector are shifted into this shift register. Once we complete shifting all the bits of the received vector, we are going to get n minus k syndrome bits, which is the remainder of the division. Remember, R of X by G of X is the division which is implemented in this circuit. And the remainder of that division will be available in these flip-flops known as the syndrome bits. And once that is done, then we'll switch on gate 1, turn off gate 2. And with gate 1 enabled, the syndrome bits are shifted out onto the transmission line or whatever you are, wherever you want to process the syndrome, error correction circuit, anywhere. So as you can see here, the register is first initialized with gate 2 on, gate 1 off. So this is on and this is off initially. Okay, initially, and the received vector is put into the shift register. After entire received vector has been shifted, contents of the registers, each of these sub-registers or flip-flops, will be the syndrome, which can be shifted out of the register by turning gate 1 on and gate 2 off. So now the circuit is ready for processing the next received vector. Received one vector, we have the syndrome. Now you can take the next received vector. It's as easy as this. That's why we prefer cyclic codes to linear block codes, because of the ease of design of syndrome calculator and encoder. So as we had discussed, cyclic codes are extremely well suited for error detection. They can be designed to detect many combinations of likely errors, and implementation of error detecting and error correcting circuits is practical and highly simple. So error detection can be achieved by employing or adding an additional RS flip-flop. So at the end of this syndrome calculator, I can put one RS flip-flop, and based on the output, okay, I can set or reset this flip-flop. If syndrome is 0, the flip-flop remains reset. Output is 0. If the if the output is 1, then sorry, if this gate 1 output is 1, then the flip-flop will be set. You can simply use an SR flip-flop like this, okay, to detect whether there's an error or not. So all error detecting circuits, most of them use cyclic codes rather than linear block codes. So the circuit can also be written like this, the same circuit, except we have replaced the gates with AND gates. Gate 1 is also an AND gate, gate 2 is also AND gate, and we have listed the hardware requirements for the syndrome calculator. You need N minus K bit shift register, S0 to SN minus K minus 1, maximum of N minus K modulo 2 adders, because there is one at every input. So if all the generator coefficients are high, all modulo 2 adders will be used, otherwise lesser will be used. That's why we say maximum of N minus K modulo 2 adders. A max of N minus K switches. Each of these are switches, G1, G2. If the coefficient is high, the switch is closed. If it is zero, the switch is open. Two AND gates, as can be seen. Now, let's see two different methods of error detection and correction. According to method 1, first you obtain the H transpose matrix and then compare the syndrome S with rows of H transpose, and the row that matches corresponds to the position of error. See, whenever I get a non-zero syndrome, we already have our syndrome calculator circuit, and whenever you get a non-zero syndrome, you know there is error. Now, how do you determine the position of error? To determine the position of error, we are doing this. The first option is you get the H transpose matrix for the cyclic code and then compare the syndrome obtained with rows of H transpose. Whichever row matches, that particular bit is in error, counting from the left in the received vector. Okay, so you check the received vector and start counting the bits from the left. Whichever position you had got, that matching position in the of the syndrome with H transpose, that position starting counting from the left is considered to be in error. So how do you correct it? You just have to toggle that particular bit, or you write an error pattern with a 1 in that particular bit and then add that error pattern to the received vector to get the corrected code vector VCAP. This is our standard procedure which we have followed in linear block codes. The same thing we are stating as method 1 here also. But we have another easier method known as method 2. Here we know that after n clock cycles, we would have entered all the bits in the received vector into the syndrome calculator circuit, and the syndrome will be available. Okay, but we have to continue entering zeros even after the received vector is complete, till the point where I will get this combination as the syndrome. So what are we trying to do? After n clock cycles and after entering received vector completely, if you get a syndrome which is not zero, so you get some syndrome bits and the value is not zero, you don't stop there. You continue entering zeros into that syndrome calculator circuit till the point where the syndrome value, the syndrome becomes 1 followed with all zeros. Why this particular syndrome? If you remember, your H transpose matrix is going to be in the form IN minus K and P in cyclic code. Why in this form? Because generator is in the form what? Parity first and then identity. The generator has parity first and then identity. So H transpose will surely have identity on top and parity below. Similarly, if you want to check H, H will be having identity first and then P transpose. Okay, so the parity check matrix will be identity first and then, and if I have the identity matrix as the topmost in H transpose, what would be the first row? The first row corresponds to 1 followed with zeros. The first row in an identity matrix is 1 followed by all zeros, right? So that's why we continue entering the zeros into the syndrome calculator till I get the first row of the H transpose matrix. Now, when I get that, we stop entering zeros and we count how many clock cycles have been completed totally. So say for example, for a 7-bit received vector, I have completed 12 clock cycles. Now, I will start counting the received vector starting with the position. So from the left, I'll show you how it is done. Okay, here, say I have some received vector, something like this, 7-bit received vector, and n value, the number of clock cycles is 12. We'll start counting from the leftmost position, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and again we will revert back from this end, 8, 9, 10, 11, this is your 12th position. You are just counting the bit positions in the received vector based on the number of clock cycles. And whichever position matches, that position you have to toggle or change to get the corrected code vector. That's all. So this is method 2. Let's take example and see how these two methods work. So in the given example, it's a 7,4 cyclic code with generator polynomial given as 1 plus x plus x cube. You are supposed to draw the syndrome calculation circuit. Also detect and correct errors for the following received polynomials. The first one, R1 is 1101001. R2 is also given. We'll do for both. By showing the contents of the shift register for each clock cycle. Please take care if this is mentioned. Generally in cyclic codes, you have to show the contents of shift registers after each clock cycle. In the sense, we have to write equations and compute. Okay. Also verify the same using conventional equation based method. Okay. So first let's draw the syndrome calculator circuit. Here, how many flip-flops I need? I need n minus k, that is 3 flip-flops in shift register. So we'll draw 3 flip-flops and write the values S0, S1, S2. 3 flip-flops are sufficient. Next, look at the generator. What is the generator value? G of x is 1 plus x cube, which means that G0 is 1, which shows this short circuit here. Then what about G1? G1 is also 1, which means there is a short circuit or closed loop here also. So we need this modulo 2 adder as well as this. And G2 is 0. X square term is not present. So the coefficient of x square term is 0, which means I don't have a connection here. This is an open circuit, no connection, which means this modulo 2 adder need not be included. I need not add anything. Nothing is coming back from here. No need to add. So just short the output of this second flip-flop directly as input to the third flip-flop S2. Okay. We can avoid this modulo 2 adder. Now, the output of S2 should be given as input to gate 2. This is gate 2, and gate 1 also we give output of S2 as the input, and initially we are going to enable gate 1 so that we will be able to enter all the received bits, vectors or received bits into this shift register, and the division is computed and the remainder bits will be available in the flip flops. Later on we'll enable gate 2 and shift those remainder bits outside. That's the standard procedure. So already we discussed this. Now let's try to see the tabular entry step by step. In general, for every clock cycle which we list here, so this is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7. Okay, initially there is nothing, AND gate 1 is enabled and 2 is disabled, and all the syndrome bits in the flip flops are zeros. So all syndrome bits are zeros. And remember I told you we'll consider the input side as having superscript I, output side as O, and I'll always consider at the rising edge the input is available in, it moves into this flip flop, and at the falling edge the bit moves out of the flip flop. Okay, so usually in one clock cycle we have rising and falling. At rising edge the data shifts inside, at falling edge the data shifts outside. That's how we have considered. So the input sides have been considered as SOI and S0O, S1I, S1O, S2I and S2O. Now can we write the equations at each stage? What would be the value of S0I? Now to determine the values of these bits, say SOI on the input side will be R, I can write it as okay, this can be written as R plus G. If I call the output of this gate as G in general, this bit SOI will be R plus G. And similarly, S1I, the input to the second flip-flop, can be written as G coming from here plus the output of the previous flip-flop SO. O or S00. Okay, it can be the value of output of previous flip-flop plus the G value which comes from gate 1. Next, this S2I can be written as S10. Okay, S2I can be directly written as S10, and finally this would be available. So considering this, we have considered the clock input, the received vector. Remember, we have considered received vector as 1101001. The last bit should enter first. This should be the first entry into the circuit. Okay, so one is entering and we are computing the value of G in each case. Okay, from the circuit, if initially remember this G will be calculated as the value of S2O. This S2O is coming, this gate is enabled, means this is high. So G is directly equal to S2O. I can say the G value will be S2O. If I consider all these equations in the next table, it becomes easy. So this G is equal to S2O. Yeah, we have all these equations. SOI is equal to G plus RI, the received vector. S1I is S10 plus G, and S2I is, sorry, S0O plus G. This is S10. All the equations what we have written, if we directly, so initially when there was no input, all the values were zero. When I enter the first clock, the first bit entering, the LSB bit 1, G value will be the previous value of S2O, that is it is 0. So G becomes 0. SOI becomes G plus RI. RI is this and G is this. 1 plus 0, it is 1. S1I becomes S0O plus G. See, S0O was 0. So 0 plus G is also 0 in this case. So I'm going to get a 0. Next, S2I is S1O. S1O was 0, so S2I will also be 0. So the values of S0, S1 and S2 are 1, 0, 0, which will be shifted to the output side of the flip-flops on the falling edge of the clock. Likewise, in the second clock cycle, the second bit after LSB, to the left of LSB, 0 is fed in. And again, G is computed. G should be computed checking what was the value of S2 in the previous case. S2 was 0, so G will remain 0 here also. And using these equations, we are going to compute S0I, S1I, so on. As I was telling you in encoder, here in decoder also, we need not write it twice. If you are familiar enough with these equations, you just have to remember, you have to consider the previous value and you can directly write the table without writing it as input side, output side, all that we can avoid. Okay. So at the end of 7 clock pulses, you can see the MSB bit has entered 1 and the G value is computed and S0, S1 and S2 are given as 101, and that is available as the final syndrome. So this is your final syndrome. Okay, 101. Let's verify whether that syndrome is right using the standard method. In the standard method, we know G of X is given as 1 plus x cubed. And okay, we are talking about error correction. The verification is not done here, I think. Yeah, here we have done the verification. The verification is obtained by dividing R of X with G of X. R of X was double one, I think. How many zeros? Let me check. 101001. Yeah, this was the this was the received vector. So it is written as 1 plus x cube plus 4, 5, x power 6. You see 1 plus x cube plus x power 6. That should be divided with the generator. And when we divide, you see, using standard principles of division, we are going to get the result as 1 plus x square, which is corresponding to the value 101. It matches with the syndrome which we have obtained in this table. Okay. Now, in method two of correction, what do? We are going to enter zeros in method two. I will go on add zeros till what? Till syndrome becomes 100, 1 followed with zeros. You see, the first zero I add, G value becomes 1. And in the first case itself, I am getting the syndrome as 100. So syndrome has already become 100 in the 8th clock cycle. So what should we do? We will consider the received vector 1101001. Start counting first, second, third, this will be seventh, and come back eighth, which means to say eighth clock cycle, I have got the correct syndrome, the first row of H transpose. So this bit is in error. all I have to do is change that bit. Therefore, corrected code vector will be 1101000. Instead of 1, I am changing it to 0 to get the corrected code vector. In method 1 for error detection and correction, what should we do? We have to find the H transpose matrix, for which I should start from the generator. Remember, parity check polynomial is not given. Only generator is given. How do I get H of X? By dividing X to the power of 7 plus 1 with generator X cube plus X plus 1. When we do this division, we are going to get the parity check polynomial as X power 4 plus X square plus X plus 1. This is your H of X. We have already discussed how to get the H matrix from the polynomial. I should find H of X inverse. Then I should start multiplying X power K with H of X inverse. So X power K into H of X inverse, I'm just multiplying. Okay. You see? So you get the first row. And if you right shift this X power K plus 1 into H of X inverse, you're getting second row. X power K plus 2 into H of X inverse, you'll get third row. And I told you just right shift this by 1 bit, you get second row, right shift by 2 bits, third row. But this is not in the standard form if you observe. This should be in the standard form. I should have had it as what? I and then P. But this is not in standard form. So how do I bring it to standard form? If I have to bring this to standard form, I have to do row manipulations. I know that only the first row is out of order than what is needed for a identity matrix. So you just take the first row, add it to the third row and replace it in the first row. So now I have it in the standard form, IN minus K and P transpose H. Therefore, what is H transpose? Transpose of this matrix. Therefore, H transpose will be IN minus K and P. P transpose of transpose makes it P. You see, this becomes H transpose. How do I find the syndrome from H transpose? You just have to match the syndrome. What was our syndrome? 101. Match it with the rows of the H transpose. You are getting a match in this. This is matching, right? So what does it mean? The error pattern should have a 1 in the last bit position. The 7th bit position should be a 1. And the corrected code vector is received vector plus the error pattern. So the last bit is corrected, which matches with whatever we have done here also. See, the corrected code vector is 1101000. Even in the other method, we are getting the same. Okay. Now, let's consider the same thing for the second received vector, 41011. So it's the same technique. Initially, all values are zeros. Later on, in the rising edge, the received bit, this bit should come in first. One, G value is computed. We know the G value is S2O. This value 0, so G will be 0. S naught I is what? R plus G. S naught I will be R plus G. 1 plus 0 is a 1. S1 I will be S naught O plus G. S naught O previously was a 0. 0 plus G is also 0, so this is a 0. S2i is directly S1o in our circuit. We had written these equations just now when we took the other received vector R1. So we see S2o is 0. So S2i in the current state is 0. 100 is passed on to the final output of the flip-flops. The next received bit 1 is fed in. Again, similar computations. And at the end of 7 clock cycles, if you observe, you are getting the syndrome bits as 011. So this is your syndrome. Since it is not 0, it indicates a condition of error, right? When syndrome bits are not 0, that means there is error. And if there is error, I know with one method, I'll just go on feeding in zeros till I get the first row of H transpose 100. So here we have added 3 more zeros. At the 10th clock pulse, I have got 100, the first row. So how do I correct it? I know I'll consider the received vector, start counting from the left, and again back from right to left, left to right and right to left, like this. 10th clock pulse means it corresponds to this bit. That bit has to be changed. So you can write an error pattern. I told you there are two ways. Directly toggle, it gives you the same result, easier way. Or you write the error pattern with 1 in this bit position and add this to the received vector. When you do that, modulo 2 addition results in the corrected code vector with this bit changed from 0 to 1. Same answer. Okay. This is the best way to do it in cyclic codes rather than writing H transpose and all that. Writing the H transpose matrix is going to be more cumbersome. Doing it directly by writing the table and extending the table till you get the first row of H transpose is easier. Okay. Now, before winding up, let's discuss about general decoding circuit for N, K cyclic code. So we can have a general decoder circuit. Let me directly explain this circuit. This is the circuit. As usual, we have a syndrome calculator. The syndrome calculator has a syndrome register with N minus K flip-flops and feedback connections to these flip-flops. We know, we have implemented that, we have seen those registers here. Something like this. This circuit is what we are depicting there. Okay. So, generalized syndrome calculator initially with a syndrome register and feedback connections. And remember the input, received vector input has to be fed in. So, it is fed in through this point and to the syndrome calculator, another input modulo 2 adder is there. Okay. And when is the received code word fed in? When switch S in is closed. When this switch is closed, it will be closed here also. The received vector will be directly fed into this lower buffer register and also into the syndrome calculator. After N clock pulses, this syndrome calculator will be having the syndrome as the remainder. It will be present in the shift register. Those syndrome bits are shifted down to the error pattern detector. This error pattern detector is going to be a combinational logic circuit which you can design. And this error pattern detector will output a high only if this rightmost bit is in error. If rightmost bit is in error, the output of this error pattern detector will be 1. Meaning to say, if this bit is not an error, it will give you a 0. Now, if this is a 1, this S out is then closed at both these points. So this buffer register here has the received vector, right? The complete received vector R is present in the buffer register. The rightmost bit, whatever is the rightmost bit, Rn minus 1 will be shifted out to which the error pattern will be added. So Rn minus 1 plus E, I'm going to get the corrected code bit Vn minus 1. So the rightmost bit would be corrected in the first step. Now, what happens if the buffer register contents are observed. Also the syndrome register. The syndrome register, if it has all zeros, that means there are no more errors. There was one bit in error which has been corrected. But if the syndrome register is not zero, and if this buffer register has not emptied, it is non-zero. Remember, bit by bit, we are shifting it out, all the n bits. It will again recompute the syndrome for the shifted version of the buffer register. So the syndrome is again computed. Again, the error pattern detector will generate an output bit as one if there is an error in the rightmost position. And the next rightmost position is RN-2 will be added to this error pattern and corrected. I am going to get VN-2. Likewise, this repeats for all the N code bits which are received in the received vector. And after N clock cycles, we should hope the buffer register should also have zero, and the syndrome register should also have zero. Meaning to say, whatever error pattern was there, that has been detected and corrected. But if at all that doesn't happen, if the buffer register or syndrome register are not zero, that means we have encountered an error pattern which could not be corrected. We could not correct that error pattern using this circuit. So an incorrectable pattern was received. That's how we understand the behavior of this circuit. So you can just read through. Received data is shifted into the buffer register and syndrome registers with switches S in closed and S out opened. And error correction is performed with S in open and S out closed. As I told you, after syndrome for received code word is calculated and placed in syndrome register, those contents are read to error detector. Detector is a combinational logic circuit which will output a 1 if and only if the syndrome corresponds to a correctable error pattern with error against the highest order position, rightmost position, x^n-1. So that corresponds to the rightmost bit in the received vector. If it is a 1, we close the switches S out, shift that received bit and the error error pattern detector output bit, and we will correct that particular code bit and send it out. Okay, so this we repeat as we do it for all the n bits of the received vector. And at the end of decoding operation, that is after received code word is shifted out of the buffer completely, all the errors corresponding to correctable error patterns should have been corrected. And the syndrome register should contain all zeros. If it doesn't happen, which means an uncorrectable error pattern has been detected. Okay, so we can use this generalized decoder for cyclic codes. With this, we are completing our module 4. And we have completed the concept of cyclic codes, understanding the concept of error detection and correction in cyclic codes, and writing or drawing a syndrome calculation circuit for cyclic codes. And with two methods, we were able to detect and correct for errors. We'll continue in the next class with special codes. Thank you.